shout till it almost physically hurts. Shout victory. Shout dominion. Shout authority. Shout glory. Glory! Glory! Shout because you can. Shout because you want to. Shout because there's nothing the devil can do about it. Clap because you can. Clap because you want to. Clap. Show your authority. Skin on skin. Let every devil know they have no authority in your life. Clap it out. Clap it out. Clap it out. Well, hallelujah. You can be seated. You can be seated. Blessed be the name of God forever. I said, blessed be the name of God forever. My pastor, my mentor, was recognized as one of the foremost authorities on demon power. Now, this is not for the spiritually weak of heart and mind. We are engaged in warfare. Look at your neighbor and say, this right up in here. Say it the way I said, this right up in here is not a recreation room. This is a battlefield. Now shout because you were built for the battle. You were created for the conflict. Luke 9:1 shouts it. Behold, I feel it in here now. Behold, 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 I give you power. Wonder-working power. Sin eradicating power, devil destroying power, death to life again, power, tumor driving out, power, confusion rectifying, power, sleep disorder healing, power, heart malfunction, power. Behold! Oh, I feel like saying behold. Somebody's going to get an infusion. Somebody's about to realize you are on an irreversible collision course. There ain't nothing you do about it now. You're committed. You've come too far. You have advanced too far into enemy-held territory to not have to fight. You ought to just get a habit. You ought to just get a habit. You ought to just get a habit. Cause you got the devil on the run. You wouldn't have to fight if you weren't where you are. You wouldn't have to fight if God didn't think you could win. God already placed his bet on Calvary and doubled it when he raised him from the dead and said, the same spirit that raised up Christ from the dead now dwells in you. The only reason to have a body is just to express the life that's in it. So go ahead and let her go. Let me just lay a couple of things out. You can be seated. You might just as well get happy, because you've come way too far to turn back now. You have already gained hell's attention. They have you in their sights. Just smile at them real big. God, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Satan hath desired to have you. Now there was a reason that he didn't pick out John the Apostle, or Matthew, or Mark, or Luke. He specifically, with great specificity, zeroed in on Simon Peter. And he said, Simon, yeah, you better wake up, Simon. Satan, not a demon. I'll talk. Satan has desired to have you. There's a prophecy for you. Actual translation is Satan has requisition, because he can't do anything without permission. What, did you think I was going to come in here tonight and brag on the devil? He's defeated. Can't have my mind, can't have my body, can't have my family, can't have my future, can't have my money, can't have my church. Somebody needs to go ahead and shout. He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet.
Yes, he is.
You might just well know it. You may see it. You might just well know it. It's over for you. You turn around and show fear now. You are way too deep into enemy hell territory. Huh? Don't let him see you sweat. Don't let him see you fear. Don't let him see you in trepidation. Don't let him hear you do anything but glorify God, who gives you the victory. I have no thought of defeat. I have no thought of demise. I have no thought of falling. No. I'm saying a whole lot more than you're getting. You, shall I, have come too far into enemy held territory. You flinch now, you've had it. I'm preaching to somebody. You could have shown him fear. You were over at the frozen chosen. Just assigned a couple of little failures to torment you a little bit. But look at you now. Born again. Blood washed. You looking like your daddy. Talking like your elder brother. Moving like the Holy Ghost. You've come too far now. There is no retreat for you now. Dude, I'm telling you, I'm under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost right now. Don't let him see you flinch. Come on. And if you feel like flinching, grab four people around you and say, just stand around me and shout. You flinch now and it'll open the door to some disease. You flinch now and he'll get a headway into your children. Don't you flinch now. Are you kidding me? You're a part of a church? Harvest Preparatory School went to a track meet last week. And the bus driver just sat on the bus. A track meet. And the bus driver just sitting on the bus. Waiting on the children, you know. Waiting on the athletes. Somebody came knocking on the bus door. May I help you? Yeah. Do you go to that church? Yeah. Well, I need to get saved. He knelt down on the bus, gave his life to Jesus, and got up speaking in other tongues. You come too far. You with a crazy bunch now. You've been identified. You've been marked out. You can't mess around with this now. You can't play at it now. You can't ease up now. And why would you want to? Every time you shout, they scream. Every time you rejoice, they retreat. Every time you glorify, they get bludgeoned. Hey! Behold, I give you power over all devils and to cure diseases. Go ahead and ask three people, got anything you need cured of? Because you're on the right pew. Now just pray for everybody on your pew right now to be healed. Just release that anointing right there in Elkhart, Indiana. Release it right here. Be healed. Rebuke that torment. Rebuke that sad spirit. Rebuke that downcast attitude. Now just glorify God that he's just touched 1,000 people. I give you power over all devils and to cure diseases. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power. That young man right back there with the white shirt and the glasses, climb over every pew and come to me right now. Everybody else get to glorifying God. Oh, it's you. All I saw was a white shirt, but I saw, as it were, as Moses was parting the Red Sea and the waters were rolling back, so is the door that I place before you, says the Lord. And there will come an anointing from generations past into you this night, says the Almighty. And when you step off the airplane, demons will run and flee. miracles of deliverance. Devils will cry out. Don't let them interrupt your message. Say, hush, and sit down till I'm finished. God says to you this night, command ye me the works of my hands. I've been looking for a partner like you, says the Lord. Blair. Who is this?
This is Leonardo. He's a student at Valor. He's a graduate at Valor from Brazil.
You're from Brazil?
He travels all over the world going out on the missions field.
Deliverance! Deliverance to the nations! Prophesy to those flags! They're coming from Uganda. They're coming from Korea. They're coming from England. They're coming from all over the world. God woke me up 2 nights ago and said, I'm opening the floodgates of the world into Valor Christian College. All right, get him out of here. Get him out of here now.
In Jesus' name.
Behold, I give you power. Shout, I've got it. Aaron Mayberry, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I release the anointing upon you now. Get to the teaching in a minute. I'm just the exact opposite of most preachers you know. They preach first and then the deliverance comes. Well, it's here now, and that ringing in your ears just stopped too. Ooh. All right. Behold, Luke 10:19. I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. You have an adversary. You do not have 100 adversaries. And you do not war against flesh and blood, but against powers, against principalities, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. Did you notice? It's your responsibility. Did you notice it's your responsibility? Your armor is laying at your feet. My suggestion to you would be, pick it up, put it on, learn to use it. For the weapons of our warfare are not fleshly, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, the casting down of imaginations, and every high and lofty thing that attempts to exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought. Lord God, may the meditation of my heart be pleasing unto you. Shove your neighbor and say, what are you thinking about? Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are holy, whatsoever things are of a good report, think on these things. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus also. Having this mind, put away all filthiness and vainglory and evil speaking. James 4:7 puts it in this terminology. Well, first of all, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, you have to pay attention to whens and ifs. He said, when you pray. He did not say, if you pray. He's presupposing, he's assuming that you are going to pray. But then he says, if my people, now he's not convinced. He's watched us. He's seen our past performance. If my people who are called by my name, what name? That name given above every name, at the sound of that name, every demon has to flee. For in that name all power is given to set the helpless captives free. Every pain, disease, and sickness must bow to that name and forevermore surrender. Throughout all time I shall proclaim. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, hear me now, then will I hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. That's something to an orphan. That's good news to a weakling. That's shouting material to the defeated. That announces to heaven and hell itself that I am superior to the forces of darkness. Superior to the forces of darkness. There must be birthed within the church a desire to change. You have already struck out on an irreversible collision course with the adversary. Now don't try to get up and run out. Now it's too late. You see, you're committed. You're too far behind enemy lines. That's why you need each other. That's why you've got to stop fighting each other. You don't know what they did to me. I know this. You'd have been a whole lot better with them than you are without them. We need each other. bone to bone. Hallelujah. Behold, I give you, let me get over to James 4:7. That's where I'll start. James 4:7 gives us the key. Now it starts off with something nobody likes to shout about. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Cannot submit myself to God if I'm not submitted to men. That went over big. Let me try this side over here. You cannot be submitted to God unless you are submitted to godly authority. There are no lone rangers in the kingdom. There are no I can do it on my own folk in the kingdom. I need to announce to you tonight, demon power is real. Jesus spoke about it. He called Satan a real person, a personhood. Satan. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Now, you want me to get real deep? I could hang out right here quite a while. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Submit yourself, therefore, unto God. Miss Joni keeps bringing it up to me because, you know, sometimes I preach things and then she'll grab a hold of them and just drive me into the ground with them. Here's what she's been rehearsing. Not to me, not like at me, but in our home. She's been saying it. Over and over and over and over. Do you know what I'm talking about? You don't. Well, you sure do talk about it a lot. Do you know? Look at the two of you. Messing up my illustration. God cannot bless you. Now, have you got it? Oh, look at them. All of a sudden, they've been enlightened. Well, stand up and tell me what it says then. Go ahead. God cannot bless you beyond your last act of disobedience. One of the problems you have with allowing devils to torment your life is because you need to back up, make something right. Go back to that pastor you talk about all the time and ask his forgiveness. Go back to that person whom offended you. Do you know that the onus is not on the offending party? It's on you. Oh my God, you were doing real good when I was, you know, getting into that. Behold, I give you. Hallelujah. All right, I'll get off of it. Submit yourself, therefore, unto God. Then resist the devil. Well, if he wasn't real, why would God command us to resist him? Resist the devil. How? In word, thought, and deed. I just quoted it to you a moment ago. Weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're mighty through God. The pulling down of strongholds, casting down of imaginations, every high and lofty thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Your victory will be won or lost in the arena of your thought life. I said, shove your neighbor and ask him, what are you thinking about? If you're a man and you're thinking about women that aren't your life, you'll be bound by lust. It got really quiet. Resist the devil in word, thought, and deed. Notice the reverse antithesis of God's word to you. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty through God. Watch. To the pulling down of strongholds. It didn't start as a stronghold. It may be a stronghold now, but it didn't begin that way. The casting down of imaginations, image, revolving it over and over again in your thought life. How you're going to fail. How you're never going to win. How you're never going to be well. How you're never going to get that weight off. How you're never going to get a man to treat you right, so you put up with a devil. You were shouting so good a while ago. Submit yourself therefore unto God, then resist the devil. All right? So it doesn't start as it doesn't begin as a stronghold. Begins before that as an imagination. That boy did not backslide in the hog pen. It started when he was sitting on the front row. And he lost his shout. And he got out of the word. And he got weary. And instead of running to God, ran away from God. Imagination. You begin to imagine, image in your mind. You imagine. You drive down the road and some lady in a slinky dress with a whiskey sour or some other in her hand. Now, my good friend, gone to be with the Lord now, E.V. Hill, his mama kind of cured that business. She took him out. He got to be about 15 years old, and he decided that he is going to drink. She caught him at it. So she said, well, that's all right. Said, go in there and put your two or three of those outfits I bought you in a little satchel and come on out here. She put him in the car. She drove him down to what they used to call Skid Row. She took him down where the winos are lying in their own urine and where the sexually transmitted diseases are floating down like open sewers. And she opened the door in that dimly lit street and said, get out now. He said, oh, no, I don't want to be here. She said, no, these are your friends now. This is where you're going to end up. So you might as well get to know them now. It doesn't start as a stronghold. It starts with watching a movie you had no business watching. It starts with listening to music you had no business listening to. It starts telling jokes that you had no business telling. It starts with a little flirtation. And the next thing you know, you've ruined your life and everybody's around you. Give no place. The word place, topos. Give no, write it down. Give no place to the devil. The word place, topos. Give no position of opportunity to the devil. Get him out of your thought life. You're driving down the road and some half-clothed thing on a billboard with a whiskey sour. Cast down that imagination. I said cast it down like you would cast it out. Somebody shout, come out! Some of you just need to lay your hands on your temples right now and just say, in the name of Jesus, I take authority over you. I take authority over that thought life. I take authority over that rebellious spirit. I take authority over that depression. I take authority over that sadness. Now, in the name of Jesus, go! You just got a deliverance. She just got a deliverance. I mean, I saw it leave her. Just like a whirlwind. I'm telling you, she got a deliverance. That thing came right out of her mind. Now shout and don't come back. this is good. I studied 12 hours of this and said one thing I had prepared. You wait till it's a stronghold and you can't get deliverance on your own. That went right over your head. Some of you have licked your wounds, pouted. I rebuke that pouting spirit right now. I feel it. I feel it. I can sense it just the same as I can sense cancer. I'm telling you right now, stop it. Stop it. Quit manipulating your husband. Honey, what's wrong? Nothing. Nothing. I'm fine. No, you're not, you devil. That's a wicked spirit. And there's no truth in it. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Come on now, we're not going to be pouters. I'll tell you right now, I've been delivered from pouting. Hallelujah. I'm from Eastern Kentucky. We'll duke it out and 10 minutes later go to dinner. I don't got time for you to look out the window and stare hopelessly at him. What's wrong? Nothing. You just lied. There is something wrong. You know exactly what it is. And if there's not, turn that frown upside down, get a smile on your face, lift up your hands, go in the bathroom and talk 15 minutes in tongues and get yourself straightened out. Because the next thing you know, that'll open the door and a spirit of depression will come on you that will become a stronghold and you won't be able to set yourself free. Glory to God, right now, you can set yourself free. You're not pouting, are you? Hey, you're not pouting, are you? I thought maybe he was pouting and left. No, she's a Parsley, she don't pout. Hallelujah. She'll tell you off in a New York minute, but she don't. All right, are you getting this now? All right. It does not begin with a stronghold. Before that, down the road, there was an imagination. Run from the appearance of evil. Run from it. Treat it like you treat a rattlesnake in the pew with you right now. Some of you got a couple next to you. You might just well shout now. I'm having a time. God, deliver us from wicked and unruly people. What's an unruly person? A person who is incapable of a sustained, harmonious relationship. They're up today and down tomorrow. They're mad at that one yesterday and that one tomorrow. They're pouting about this one and they're not speaking to that one. That's an unruly spirit. Oh, God, deliver us. What a waste of time. Well, if you can't shout because I'm preaching to you, shout because I'm preaching to the person next to you. Go ahead. And it doesn't begin as an imagination. It begins as a thought. So when you think that thought, you must do it. Bring that thought captive. That means hold it and don't let it go. And make it submit to the word of God. Make it. You're an authority. I told you today. You're the the alpha. Alpha male, alpha female. You're in control. The devil is not. You're in authority. Your spirit man, that born again ego that was so evil when it was leavened before God chose you. But after God chose you, he raises that thing up on the inside of you as if to say, I know who I am, and you made me this way, and I'm not just about ready to be some other way. You said I would have joy unspeakable and full of glory. Now thought come captive in Jesus' name. I'm teaching you about demon power now. Submit yourself unto God. Resist the devil. In word, everybody just shout, hey devil. No, I want you to get used to saying it. Hey, devil. You can't touch this. Now go! You spirit of lust, go! You binding, tormenting spirit that says I won't be able to sleep tonight, go! You spirit of failure that tries to attach yourself to me, you're not of God, I bind you now. I'm having a time. And if you'll do that, he will flee from you. I'm going to give you a quote that I've lived by for 30 years. You want it? I'm telling you, I had a time with those Valor Christian College interns the other day. I had 20 of them in a room captive for about an hour and a half. And I really do appreciate them allowing me to come and speak to them. They were just like sponges, like you are tonight, just soaking up. And I believe I gave them this quote. I've lived by it. You ready? I share it with my children. I share it in my home. Temptation, which you're going to have in this world. You're not delivered out of this world. You're in this world, but you're not of it. Are y'all cold? I see everybody wrapping up. Are you all right? You're a little bit cold. Well, I rebuke you, devil. Now, listen to me. Listen to me. Temptation. Now look me in the eye. You're going to have it. You're not above it. You're not above Jesus, are you? Bible said he was tempted in every point. Tempted. He knew the bite, the distraction of temptation, yet without sin. Here's the quote. Temptation, when habitually kept at a distance, will cease to exist. If you'd be honest right now, what you're tempted by demon power about, you may not even know it's demon power tempting you. God tempts no man with evil. But we're tempted when we're drawn away. It's a fishing term, to lure. When we're drawn away and enticed, that's a hunting term, and enticed to surround by our own lust, our own desire. Don't think about it sexually in that connotation. By our own desire. Anything that I can't stop thinking of is an idol. Anything that I give all my heart is an idol. You with me? Temptation. when habitually kept at a distance, ceases to exist. If you have a problem with alcohol and you're getting on a commercial airplane, tell the stewardess, don't bring that by me. Well, I don't want to offend her. Better to offend her than for you to end up an alcoholic. If you have a problem with gossip, stay out of situations that gender it. I don't know how I got on this. Temptation, when habitually kept at a distance, ceases to exist. Resist the devil means flee, to run away. One Bible translation translates it this way: as running away with inspired fear and threatened danger. That'll kill you. You know why you run away when you hear and you're walking through a Texas field? Inspired fear and threatened danger. When you begin to treat your temptation with inspired fear and threatened danger, that thing will kill you. That thing will destroy your life. That thing will wreck your home. That thing will leave you shipwrecked. Cast that thought down. Shout, come out. Go. I resist you right now in word and deed. That means get up from the table and walk away. I was with Brother Copeland. We were sitting at a table with a bunch of preachers. And all of a sudden, they started talking about other preachers. And Brother Copeland just reached over and took me by the hand, took his napkin and his plate and said, grab yours, and moved us to another table. Now, these were nationally known preachers. He said, no, me and Brother Rod, we don't give ourselves to that. Hallelujah, praise God. Amen. Get up, walk away. I said, get up, walk away. Resist that thing. Don't let it become an imagination. Oh, hallelujah. I might ought to just quit now. Our struggle is not with flesh, but in the spirit, where we are always victorious. Your spirit shall sustain all your infirmity. Give it a chance. I feel like you're tired now. You know? When we encounter manifestations of demon power, we are to cast them out. Mark 16:17, these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. Some of you need to go home and take a bunch of those CDs, DVDs, and throw them out. Some of you need to turn your cable off. Too much of a temptation to you. By the way, what are your kids that are home, teenagers that are home right now watching? What are they filling your home with? And those spirits all in your house. Let me give you another quote I've lived by. To permit is to participate. You get pleasure out of watching somebody else do it. It won't belong till you're doing it. Dirty housewives. Amen. Don't shout me down now just because I'm preaching. you gentlemen spend a night in some hotel somewhere and watch some deplorable girl that's been sexually trafficked and made to make a movie, and you sit there in a room and watch it, and then come home, that spirit's on you, and try to make your wife do things that your Bible plainly teaches are an abomination. Uh-oh, now we've messed up. Somebody said, well, now, Brother Ron, the marriage bed is sanctified. It doesn't sanctify debauchery. Debauchery is still debauchery. Shall I get more specific? Just read your Bible. Certain things are made for certain things. You don't eat with your nose, and you don't talk with your ear. What you don't understand is you're allowing spirits of darkness to invade your life. Get it out! Clean it up! Your body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. And it doesn't matter if you're having connections with your husband, or with your spouse, with your wife. Doesn't matter. Your body's still the temple of the Holy Ghost. He doesn't go to the next room like your children. Don't grieve him. Wow. I don't think you're going to invite me back. I think they've already turned off the screen in Elkhart and gone home. Hallelujah. Well, we might as well be real. Run, flee, as if inspired with danger. Get away. Put away all filthiness, evil speaking, and clamor. Let not such things even be mentioned among you, much less giggled at on your TV set every night. What are we talking about now? We're talking about give no place. Give no position of opportunity. Let me give you another translation of space limited by occupancy. Glory to God. When I was a little boy, Mother Parsley, my precious father, would take us. We had a 64 Buick Skylark. That'd be 1964. How many of you were not alive in 1964? Well, you're here now. Hallelujah. Shout, I'm alive now. Well, a 1964 Buick Skylark. No air conditioner. It had 460 air conditioning. Four windows down and hit 60 miles an hour. Amen. We didn't stop at McDonald's either there. We had a green Coleman cooler in the trunk. You have the same thing, Joni? Yeah. Amen. Stop alongside the road, take out some trail bologna. Dad take out his pocket knife. I hate to think about what else he'd been cutting with that, but I my mouth would go to watering. Get you a big sweet onion, tomato. Some bread would stick to the roof of your mouth when you bit into it. Doesn't that sound good? Good cold Pepsi Cola on ice in the bottle. Whoever came up with cans had an uninspired thought. You get that glass bottle and drink about that much out of it and take you a bag of Lance peanuts, salty, pour them down in that. I'll have an apple pie. And we'd go. I remember my dad coming in over on Marilla Road. No, it wasn't Marilla Road. No, it wasn't Marilla Road. It was in the White House, one before that. Anyway, over off Frank Road. I I remember him coming in and saying, who's going to Florida today? Florida, that must be the other side of the world. We're going to the Free Will Baptist Convention. Put the Coleman cooler in there, and big, long trail bologna loaf. Off we went. And my dad, Mother Parsley, she'd start hollering, it's going to get dark soon. We've been in this car for 12 hours. Well, we're just going to go a little further. And we weren't looking for the Hilton nor the Hyatt. And the motels had those signs, vacancy. We never did see one. My dad drives along, it was no vacancy everywhere. Had to keep driving to the next town. And then everybody closed up at dark, and gasoline stations closed down, and you got no gas. By this time, it's not pleasant in the 64 Buick Skylark. It's not pleasant now. Babies. Sometimes, if we're really going to live like we ought to live, we got to put up a no vacancy sign. No, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. My body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. I have no room in my mind for anything other than what God's Word says about me. Now I'm going to tell you what demons are. You want me to? It's 8:30, right on the nose. I said, I'm going to tell you what demons are now that I've told you how to get rid of them. If you will, the Arndt translation of the Bible says the devil will seek safety in flight. He'll flee. He'll seek safety in flight. I just believe tonight that on your way home, devils are going to seek safety in flight. That when you walk over the threshold of your house, you're going to take authority over every spirit but the Holy Spirit. You go into a hotel room and you open that door before you step across that threshold. Father, in the name of Jesus, a servant of God is about to step in this room. I thank you that every spirit other than the Holy Spirit that has been manifested in this room has to go down by the power of God. You walk into a hospital on visitation. Before you walk through there on the way from the parking lot, thank you, Lord. My body resists every sickness, every disease. There's nothing in here going to get on me, but some of what's in me is going to get on this. I bind every spirit. I bind every... Glory. Lytle and Scott say the devil will run off as quickly as possible. Put him to going. The expositor's Greek New Testament says he will be vanquished and run from your presence disgraced. There are differences between physical and emotional sickness and demonic activity. Just because somebody's sick doesn't mean a demon is involved. However, one could be. Because somebody's having mental distraction does not necessarily mean there's a demon involved. But there could be. That's the reason your Bible says try the spirits and know what you're dealing with. Now here's a good way I learned to tell if the devil was involved. If somebody's acting up and I rebuke the devil in the name of Jesus and plead the blood, and they continue to act up, that's them, not the devil. Because the devil has to obey me. Boy, I'm giving you good advice. The devil has to obey you. Has no choice in the matter. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Ephesians 4:27 is what says, give no place to the devil. All right, so Brother Summerall, when he was 77 years old and had spent the past 58 years in full-time gospel ministry around the world, was writing a book He would often write. He would, when I would be in hotels with him, he would preach in the morning, and then he would talk in the afternoon, do his business with other people. Oh, look, there's a picture of him. I miss him. And he would, and then at night, he would go in the bathroom, restroom of the hotel room, and he would put the toilet seat down, and he would make that his desk, and he would sit on the edge of the bathtub as his seat, and he'd write books all night long. He was working on a book when he was 77. I saw it. I saw the transcript. It was called Scarecrow. And it was a book about demon power. And Brother Summerall had titled the book Scarecrow. He was in his bed fast asleep when suddenly he began to perspire uncontrollably. He opened his eyes, and there in the corner of his room was a manifestation of a demon spirit. It suddenly morphed itself into a television screen. And like you would, you ever see something, and then the picture's on there? Well, that's what this did. And the image had bulging eyes and a horribly contorted face, and spoke with a strange, strange voice, and said to him, "I am no scarecrow." I do not have hay for brains, and my arms do not flap in the breeze as you have described. I am Apollyon, and I will destroy America through this screen. Then he said, how do you do it? He said, number one, I will cause those behind the screen to be mockers of God. Want to talk about late night talk show hosts? Want to talk about what they do every time I'm having a prayer cloth campaign like this one right here? Every time. Mockery. The preacher used to be the most respected person in a community. And now they're the most mocked. Christians used to be revered. Now they're mocked. Most of you, most Christians, have slipped into the darkness and hide their Christianity because of the overwhelming mockery. It's cool to be Muslim. It's cool to be Jewish. Revered to be a Buddhist. And if you want to get the celebrity's attention, put a little red bracelet on. Kabbalah. But say you're a born again Christian. When you go to lunch, lay your Bible out on the table. And you'll be the most mocked person in your neighborhood. He said it was coming. And it has come like water dripping, or like you go out here on these parking lots now and you'll see little places just starting to raise up. And if you wait in just a few days, a little old blade of grass will have pushed with such consistent force that a blade of grass will push its way through a concrete slab 8 inches deep. Persistently, persistently, perverse lifestyles. Why are you watching? It's so funny. Well, he's not going to show up to you, although I wish he would, and shout, "I am Apollyon, and I've come to destroy you." He doesn't say that. Ooh, I feel God. Maybe I just need to go because I just said, I'm Apollyon and I will destroy America through this screen. Now, I believe it was the same screen, not only television. Now, you have to remember, He was 77 years old. I don't know how many years ago that would be. He'd gone to be with the Lord 16 years ago, and I believe he was 81, maybe 82 when he went to be with the Lord. So it's been a number of years ago. Computers were not what they are now. Can you imagine now? Most of you have had a really hard time resisting the temptation to watch the ball game on your cell phone while you've been in here. Some of you haven't resisted successfully. Are you listening? Are you listening? Television screens everywhere. Can't get away from them. Number two, he said, I will destroy America through this screen with music. A mockery of God, music, and the spirit of the occult. The spirit of the occult. There are three antidotes to those three spirits. The antidote to the mockery of God is exalt him. Loud and clear and strong and brag on him. And tell everybody you know how great he is. The antidote to music is pure praise and worship before God. Now, I'm not a legalist and neither is God. He changed his own law. I preached that to you this morning. I said, I'm not a legalist and neither is God. We're not bound by law, but the spirit of the law makes us free. I don't think you only have to listen to, quote, Christian music, because a lot of, quote, Christian music is not Christian at all if you knew the people singing it. So don't go getting all religious on me now. Amen. But you know what has the right spirit on it and what doesn't. A perverted spirit can be communicated to you through music more powerfully than any other medium. I don't have time to share with you why, but it is true. And thirdly, the antidote to the occult spirit is the Holy Spirit. Walk around your house and talk in tongues. Hallelujah. Worship God. Glorify him. Magnify him. Break the power of that thing and watch breakthrough. Hallelujah. What are demons? Number one, they are fallen angels. They are servants of Satan in the earth. Revelation 12:4. The dragon's tail drew one third of the stars, that translates angels, of heaven, and threw them to the earth. Satan led one third of the angels in a rebellion against God. Satan had free will, or he never could have rebelled. God did not make him rebel, but the opportunity was there. Do you understand? Because God's all about free moral agents. He's not going to make you or anybody else do anything. Secondly, there are two categories of demons. Number one, the fallen and number two, the fallen and bound. Two different kinds of demons in the earth today. All of them began as angels. There's not some pre-Adamite race that some preacher dreamed up. God did not leave demons here to torment Adam and Eve. Are you listening? All right. So there are fallen and free. We call these free spirits, wicked spirits. They're in the world today. They're commonly referred to as demons. Secondly, there are angels of light. Now, these are not the positive. These are the negative. These are demon spirits, but they're called angels of light. I can tell you about a young girl whose home I went into. I said, where is your five-year-old daughter? And she said, well, I left her at the pool. Well, is there anybody with her? No, nobody with her. And when I dug deeper into the thing, a spirit had manifested itself to her and told her that she was going to throw herself down the steps, and before she did that, take her child to the pool and put him on the edge of the pool. This is an angel of light. Your Bible calls Satan an angel of light. 2 Corinthians 11:14. Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. Matthew 12:24. Satan is the leader of these fallen and free demonic spirits called wicked spirits, and some of them take on the form of angels of light. That's the reason 1 John 4:1 says, test the spirits and know whether they're of God or not. Do you know that millions of people are deceived by preachers who are possessed by angels of light? They have great revelation. They just astound people. Angels of light to lead you astray. Secondly, there are the fallen and imprisoned spirits. 2 Peter 2:4. God did not spare the angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell. Now, this is the word Tartarus. There are several words for hell. Tartarus is a compartment in the intermediate hell, which is in the center of the earth. This is not the final hell. Are you listening? This is not the final hell. This is not where they will end up. Now, the reason this particular group of demons is not free, but your Bible says they are held in chains of darkness in a compartment of hell called Tartarus, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. Let me give you another verse. Jude 6, angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, God has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day. Do you know why they ended up there? So all of them were in the rebellion that Satan led. They were cast into the earth. Some of them are still free. They are the spirits that I could read to you many, many different instances that are involved in our world today. Things like in Germany right now, one of the major things going on is that businesses have developed where zoo animals are kept for the express purpose of men and women having sexual relations with the animals and paying the proprietors to do so. Erotic zoos, they're called. Man was just arrested in Florida for having relations, I'll say it that way, with one of those miniature donkeys, and they caught him in the act and they arrested him. And he said, well, people in the United States just need to become enlightened. I wish I could read you that quote. Let me see. Here. Amusement parks that charge a fee for individuals to have relations with the animals. People are putting newspaper ads and pimping their pets for sexual encounters with clients who pay them for the privilege. Zeta, zoophiles engaging for tolerance and enlightenment, have said, we can't do anything about being who we are, zoophiles. We are trying to handle our inclinations responsibly. Their pamphlet says, bestiality, see if you recognize this terminology. Bestiality is now normal, acceptable behavior that is genetically inherited, present at birth, and irreversible. I told you, I preached to you, in Silent No More in 2004 that America has started down the slippery slope of amoral madness when you begin to call normal and natural what God calls abomination, and when you sit and are entertained by it, that slow, consistent pressure causes you to then begin to accept what is abnormal as normal. You should recoil. It's a pathetic thing that I have to get to a place talking about zoophiles before I can even get anybody's eyebrows to raise, because nobody gets upset anymore. Nobody blushes anymore about adultery. Nobody blushes about fornication. Nobody blushes about what presidents say is not sex. No one recoils anymore when you talk about sacrificing the innocent lives of 4,200 babies on the altars of our own lust anymore. You have to get to here before anybody even raises an eyebrow. I love you. We're going to resist the devil. I said, well, there's a devil and he's real. And demons are real. And you better stay out of the way, rebuke them, release the anointing, and drive them out of your way, and let the kingdom come. Oh, hallelujah. 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 This sexual thing is something that must be addressed. Everybody else is talking about it. It looks to me like some Christians and preachers and moms and dads would stand up and tell the truth. Okay, I love the popcorn hallelujahs. The reason that those angels are bound in Tartarus, Jude 6 says they did not keep their proper domain. Genesis 6:2 tells you what happened. The fallen angels saw the daughters of men and cohabited with them, therefore producing giants in the land that were half angel and half human. They didn't just leave heaven, they'd already been cast out of heaven. They left their proper estate. They did that which was unnatural and called it natural. And God has them right now at this moment bound in chains of darkness in a place called Tartarus, in a place called Hades. But I got good news for you. They're not going to stay there. You say, how can that be good news? Because I saw an angel come down from heaven with a great chain in his hand. I got an angel and he's got a chain. I'm going to say it again. I got an angel and he's got a chain. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and it bound him 1,000 years. And after the 1,000 years was expired, death and Hades, Tartarus, gave up the dead which were in them at the great white throne judgment seat of Christ, which is not where you'll be, because the devil and his angels are going to be judged there. And blessed be God forever. Your Bible tells the final conclusion of every tormenting spirit, demon, wicked spirit, fallen angel, those free and those loosed, they get cast into the lake of fire with the false prophet and the beast. Hallelujah. And I get a ringside seat to shout. So devils, demons, fact or fiction? Demons, fact or fiction? I got 22 pages of notes. I think I'll be bringing the subject up again. Would that be all right with you? Well, I only get one Sunday night a month, and this was it, and I took all my time. Boy, I gave you a word this morning. I said I gave you a word this morning. This is the Pesach Sheni. This is the second Passover. I had a woman text me today that faithfully watches every single service we have online. And I'm telling you, she encouraged me. She said, Pastor Rod, I don't know that I ever heard a word from God like that. I was shouting all over my house. And she said, I'm doubling up on my resurrection seed because I understand now that my seed makes a demand on God that he's waiting on me to make. And I'm ready to make it. Hallelujah. Get an envelope and let's bless the Lord with our giving tonight. Praise God forever. Let's bless him with our giving tonight. Some of you could hear the voice of the Lord and do something special tonight. I know that God would be glorified and we would be grateful, as Wednesday night we really had a rushing mighty wind, but it wasn't the one we were looking for. And Wednesday night kind of got blown out the doors on us, and we really have a little deficit to make up. But how many of you believe God with me? Let's make that thing up in the name of the Lord. So whatever you would do on Wednesday night, if you didn't get it done, go ahead and do it tonight. And I believe God will be glorified. Father, bless these. We've heard your word tonight. You've manifested yourself, and I bless you for it. Get us ready for Dominion Camp Meeting. Stir our spirits. Get the atmosphere of expectancy stirred up again, oh God, in our hearts. May we resist the devil in word, thought, and deed. And we do declare and decree you've given us power over all devils and to cure diseases, to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means harm us. I release an anointing upon every one of these here tonight to cast down imaginations and bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. We resist you, Satan, and all of your cohorts in the name of Jesus. You are bound, you are cast out and rendered helpless and defeated. And we celebrate tonight that Jesus is alive and well and living in us. And we glorify you for it. Amen. Amen. Give cast into you this night, says the Almighty. And when you step off the airplane, demons will run and flee. Miracles of deliverance. Devils will cry out. Don't let them interrupt your message. Say, hush, and sit down till I'm finished. God says to you this night, command ye me the works of my hands. I've been looking for a partner like you, says the Lord. Get him up. Get him up. Get him up. Blair. Who is this?
This is Leonardo. He's a student at Valor. He's a graduate at Valor from Brazil.
You're from Brazil?
He travels all over the world going out on the missions field.
Deliverance! Deliverance to the nations! Prophesy to those flags! They're coming from Uganda! They're coming from Korea! They're coming from England! They're coming from all over the world! God woke me up 2 nights ago and said, I'm opening the floodgates of the world into Valor Christian College! Get him out of here now.
In Jesus' name. Deliverance is in the house. Deliverance is in the house. Be free in Jesus' name.
Thank you. deliverance now. Behold, behold, I give you power. Shout, I've got it. Aaron Mayberry, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I release the anointing upon you now. Get to the teaching in a minute. I'm just the exact opposite of most preachers you know. They preach first and then the deliverance comes. Well, it's here now, and that ringing in your ears just stopped too. Oh. All right. Behold, Luke 10:19, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. You have an adversary. You do not have 100 adversaries. And you do not war against flesh and blood, but against powers, against principalities, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. Did you notice it's your responsibility? Did you notice it's your responsibility? Your armor is laying at your feet. My suggestion to you would be, pick it up, put it on, learn to use it. For the weapons of our warfare are not fleshly, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, the casting down of imaginations, and every high and lofty thing that attempts to exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought, Lord God, may the meditation of my heart be pleasing unto you. Shove your neighbor and say, what are you thinking about? Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are holy, whatsoever things are of a good report, think on these things. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus also. Having this mind, put away all filthiness and vainglory and evil speaking. James 4:7 puts it in this terminology. Well, first of all, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, you have to pay attention to whens and ifs. He said, when you pray. He did not say, if you pray. He's presupposing, he's assuming that you are going to pray. But then he says, if my people, now he's not convinced. He's watched us. He's seen our past performance. If my people who are called by my name. What name? That name given above every name. At the sound of that name, every demon has to flee. For in that name, all power is given to set the helpless captives free. Every pain, disease, and sickness must bow to that name and forevermore surrender. Throughout all time, I shall proclaim. If my people, who are called by my name, shall humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, hear me now, then will I hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. That's something to an orphan. That's good news to a weakling. That's shouting material to the defeated. That announces to heaven and hell itself that I am superior to the forces of darkness. Superior to the forces of darkness. There must be birthed within the church a desire to change. You have already struck out on an irreversible collision course with the adversary. Now don't try to get up and run out. Now it's too late. You see, you're committed. You're too far behind enemy lines. That's why you need each other. That's why you've got to stop fighting each other. You don't know what they did to me. I know this. You'd have been a whole lot better with them than you are without them. We need each other. Bone to bone. Hallelujah. Behold, I give you, let me get over to James 4:7. That's where I'll start. James 4:7 gives us the key. Now it starts off with something nobody likes to shout about. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Cannot submit myself to God if I'm not submitted to men. That went over big. Let me try this side over here. You cannot be submitted to God unless you are submitted to godly authority. There are no lone rangers in the kingdom. There are no I can do it on my own folk in the kingdom. I need to announce to you tonight, demon power is real. Jesus spoke about it. He called Satan a real person, a personhood. Satan. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Now, you want me to get real deep? I could hang out right here quite a while. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Submit yourself, therefore, unto God. Miss Joni keeps bringing it up to me because, you know, sometimes I preach things and then she'll grab a hold of them and just drive me into the ground with them. Here's what she's been rehearsing. Not to me, not like at me, but in our home. She's been saying it. Over and over and over and over. Do you know what I'm talking about? You don't. Well, you sure do talk about it a lot. Do you know? Look at the two of you. Messing up my illustration. God can cannot bless you. Now have you got it? Oh, look at them. All of a sudden, they've been enlightened. Well, stand up and tell me what it says then. Go ahead. God cannot bless you beyond your last act of disobedience. One of the problems you have with allowing devils to torment your life is because you need to back up. Make something right. Go back to that pastor you talk about all the time. And ask his forgiveness. Go back to that person whom offended you. Do you know that the onus is not on the offending party? It's on you. Oh my God, you were doing real good when I was getting into that. Behold, I give you. Hallelujah. Submit yourself, therefore, unto God. Then resist the devil. Well, if he wasn't real, why would God command us to resist him? Resist the devil. How? In word, thought, and deed. I just quoted it to you a moment ago. Weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're mighty through God. The pulling down of strongholds, casting down of imaginations, every high and lofty thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Your victory will be won or lost in the arena of your thought life. I said, shove your neighbor and ask him, what are you thinking about? If you're a man and you're thinking about women that aren't your life, you'll be bound by lust. It got really quiet. Resist the devil in word, thought, and deed. Notice the reverse antithesis of God's word to you. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty through God. Watch. To the pulling down of strongholds. It didn't start as a stronghold. It may be a stronghold now, but it didn't begin that way. The casting down of imagination's image, revolving it over and over again in your thought life. How you're going to fail. How you're never going to win. How you're never going to be well. How you're never going to get that weight off. How you're never going to get a man to treat you right, so you put up with a devil. Shouting so good a while ago. Submit yourself therefore unto God, then resist the devil. All right, so it doesn't start as a stronghold. Begins before that as an imagination. That boy did not backslide in the hog pen. It started when he was sitting on the front row. And he lost his shout. And he got out of the word. And he got weary. And instead of running to God, ran away from God. Imagination. You begin to imagine, image in your mind. You imagine. You drive down the road and some lady in a slinky dress with a whiskey sour or some other in her hand. Now, my good friend, gone to be with the Lord now, E.V. Hill, his mama kind of cured that business. She took him out. He got to be about 15 years old, and he decided that he is going to drink. She caught him at it. So she said, well, that's all right. She said, go in there and put you two or three of those outfits I bought you in a little satchel and come on out here. She put him in the car. She drove him down to what they used to call Skid Row. She took him down where the winos are lying in their own urine. and where the sexually transmitted diseases are floating down like open sewers. And she opened the door in that dimly lit street and said, "Get out now." He said, "Oh no, I don't want to be." She said, "No, these are your friends now. This is where you're going to end up. So you might as well get to know them now." It doesn't start as a stronghold. It starts with watching a movie you had no business watching. It starts with listening to music you had no business listening to. It starts telling jokes that you had no business telling. It starts with a little flirtation, and the next thing you know, you've ruined your life and everybody's around you. Give no place, the word place, topos, give no, write it down, give no place to the devil. The word place, topos, give no position of opportunity to the devil. Get him out of your thought life. You're driving down the road and some half-clothed thing on a billboard with a whiskey sour. Cast down that imagination. I said cast it down like you would cast it out. Somebody shout, come out. Some of you just need to lay your hands on your temples right now and just say, in the name of Jesus, I take authority over you. I take authority over that thought life. I take authority over that rebellious spirit. I take authority over that depression. I take authority over that sadness. Now, in the name of Jesus, go! You just got a deliverance. She just got a deliverance. I mean, I saw it leave her. Just like a whirlwind. I'm telling you, she got a deliverance. That thing came right out of her mind. Now shout and don't come back. Man, this is good. I studied 12 hours of this and said one thing I had prepared. You wait till it's a stronghold and you can't get deliverance on your own. That went right over your head. Some of you have licked your wounds. Pouted? I rebuke that pouting spirit right now. I feel it. I can sense it just the same as I can sense cancer. I'm telling you right now, stop it. Stop it. Quit manipulating your husband. Honey, what's wrong? Nothing. Nothing. I'm fine. No, you're not, you devil. That's a wicked spirit. And there's no truth in it. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Come on now, we're not going to be pouters. I'll tell you right now, I've been delivered from pouting. Hallelujah. I'm from Eastern Kentucky. We'll duke it out and 10 minutes later go to dinner. I don't got time for you to look out the window and stare hopelessly at him. What's wrong? Nothing. You just lied. There is something wrong. You know exactly what it is. And if there's not, turn that frown upside down. Get a smile on your face. Lift up your hands. Go in the bathroom and talk 15 minutes in tongues and get yourself straightened out. Because the next thing you know, that'll open the door and a spirit of depression will come on you that will become a stronghold, and you won't be able to set yourself free. Glory to God, right now, you can set yourself free. You're not pouting, are you? Hey, you're not pouting, are you? I thought maybe he was pouting and left. No, she's a Parsley. She don't pout. Hallelujah. She'll tell you off in a New York minute, but she don't pout. Hallelujah. All right, are you getting this now? All right. It does not begin with a stronghold. Before that, down the road, there was an imagination. Run from the appearance of evil. Run from it. Treat it like you treat a rattlesnake in the pew with you right now. Some of you got a couple next to you. You might just well shout now. I'm having a time. God, deliver us from wicked and unruly people. What's an unruly person? A person who is incapable of a sustained, harmonious relationship. They're up today and down tomorrow. They're mad at that one yesterday and that one tomorrow. They're pouting about this one and they're not speaking to that one. That's an unruly spirit. Oh, God, deliver us. What a waste of time. Well, if you can't shout because I'm preaching to you, shout because I'm preaching to the person next to you. Go ahead. And it doesn't begin as an imagination. It begins as a thought. So when you think that thought, you must do it. Bring that thought captive. That means hold it and don't let it go. And make it submit to the word of God. Make it. You're an authority. I told you today. You're the alpha. Alpha male, alpha female. You're in control. The devil is not. You're in authority. Your spirit man, that born again ego that was so evil when it was leavened before God chose you. But after God chose you, he raises that thing up on the inside of you as if to say, I know who I am and you made me this way. And I'm not just about ready to be some other way. You said I would have joy unspeakable and full of glory. Now thought come captive. In Jesus' name. I'm teaching you about demon power now. Submit yourself unto God. Resist the devil. In word. Everybody just shout, hey devil. No, I want you to get used to saying it. Hey devil. You can't touch this. Now go! You spirit of lust, go! You binding, tormenting spirit that says I won't be able to sleep tonight, go! You spirit of failure that tries to attach yourself to me, you're not of God, I bind you now! I'm having a time. And if you'll do that, he will flee from you. I'm going to give you a quote that I've lived by for 30 years. You want it? I'm telling you, I had a time with those Valor Christian College interns the other day. I had 20 of them in a room captive for about an hour and a half. And I really do appreciate them allowing me to come and speak to them. They were just like sponges, like you are tonight, just soaking up. And I believe I gave them this quote. I've lived by it. You ready? I share it with my children. I share it in my home. Temptation, which you're going to have in this world. You're not delivered out of this world. You're in this world, but you're not of it. Are y'all cold? I see everybody wrapping up. Are you all right? You're a little bit cold. Well, I rebuke you, devil. Listen to me. Temptation. Now look me in the eye. You're going to have it. You're not above it. You're not above Jesus, are you? Bible said he was tempted in every point. Tempted. He knew the bite, the distraction of temptation, yet without sin. Here's the quote. Temptation, when habitually kept at a distance, will cease to exist. If you'd be, because somebody's having mental distraction, does not necessarily mean there's a demon involved, but there could be. That's the reason your Bible says try the spirits and know what you're dealing with. Now here's a good way I learned to tell if the devil was involved. If somebody's acting up and I rebuke the devil in the name of Jesus and plead the blood, and they continue to act up, that's them, not the devil. Because the devil has to obey me. Boy, I'm giving you good advice. The devil has to obey you. Has no choice in the matter. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Ephesians 4:27 is what says, give no place to the devil. All right, so Brother Summerall, when he was 77 years old and had spent the past 58 years in full-time gospel ministry around the world, was writing a book. He would often write, when I would be in hotels with him, he would preach in the morning and then he would talk in the afternoon, do his business with other people. Oh, look, there's a picture of him. I miss him. And he would, and then at night, he would go in the bathroom, restroom of the hotel room, and he would put the toilet seat down and he would make that his desk and he would sit on the edge of the bathtub as his seat, and he'd write books all night long. He was working on a book when he was 77. I saw the transcript. It was called Scarecrow, and it was a book about demon power. And Brother Summerall had titled the book Scarecrow. He was in his bed fast asleep when suddenly he began to perspire uncontrollably. He opened his eyes, and there in the corner of his room was a manifestation of a demon spirit. It suddenly morphed itself into a television screen. And like you ever see something, and then the picture's on there? Well, that's what this did. And the image had bulging eyes and a horribly contorted face, and spoke with a strange, strange voice, and said to him, I am no scarecrow. I do not have hay for brains, and my arms do not flap in the breeze as you have described. I am Apollyon. And I will destroy America through this screen. Then he said, how'd you do it? He said, number one, I will cause those behind the screen to be mockers of God. Want to talk about late night talk show hosts? Want to talk about what they do every time I'm having a prayer cloth campaign like this one right here? Every time. Mockery. The preacher used to be the most respected person in a community. And now they're the most mocked. Christians used to be revered. Now they're mocked. Most of you, most Christians, have slipped into the darkness and hide their Christianity because of the overwhelming mockery. It's cool to be Muslim. It's cool to be Jewish. Revered to be a Buddhist. And if you want to get the celebrity's attention, put a little red bracelet on. Kabbalah. But say you're a born-again Christian. When you go to lunch, lay your Bible out on the table. And you'll be the most mocked person in your neighborhood. He said it was coming. And it has come like water dripping, or like you go out here on these parking lots now and you'll see little places just starting to raise up. And if you wait in just a few days, a little old blade of grass will have pushed with such consistent force that a blade of grass will push its way through a concrete slab 8 inches deep. Persistently, persistently, perverse lifestyles. Why are you watching? It's so funny. Well, he's not going to show up to you, although I wish he would, and shout, I am Apollyon, and I've come to destroy you. He doesn't say that. Oh, I feel God. Maybe I just need to go because I said, I'm Apollyon and I will destroy America through this screen. Now, I believe it was the same screen, not only television. Now, you have to remember, he was 77 years old. I don't know how many years ago that would be. He'd gone to be with the Lord 16 years ago, and I believe he was 81, maybe 82 when he went to be with the Lord. So it's been a number of years ago. Computers were not what they are now. Can you imagine now? Most of you have had a really hard time resisting the temptation to watch the ball game on your cell phone while you've been in here. Some of you haven't resisted successfully. Are you listening? Are you listening? Television screens everywhere. Can't get away from them. Number two, he said, I will destroy America through this screen with music. A mockery of God, music, and the spirit of the occult. The spirit of the occult. There are three antidotes to those three spirits. The antidote to the mockery of God is exalt him. Loud and clear and strong and brag on him. And tell everybody you know how great he is. The antidote to music is pure praise and worship before God. Now, I'm not a legalist and neither is God. He changed his own law. I preached that to you this morning. I said, I'm not a legalist and neither is God. We're not bound by law, but the spirit of the law makes us free. I don't think you only have to listen to, quote, Christian music, because a lot of, quote, Christian music is not Christian at all if you knew the people singing it. So don't go getting all religious on me now. Amen. But you know what has the right spirit on it and what doesn't. A perverted spirit can be communicated to you through music more powerfully than any other medium. I don't have time to share with you why, but it is true. And thirdly, the antidote to the occult spirit is the Holy Spirit. Walk around your house and talk in tongues. Hallelujah. Worship God. Glorify Him. Magnify Him. Break the power of that thing and watch breakthrough. Hallelujah. What are demons? Number one, they are fallen angels. They are servants of Satan in the earth. Revelation 12:4. The dragon's tail drew one third of the stars, that translates angels, of heaven, and threw them to the earth. Satan led one third of the angels in a rebellion against God. Satan had free will, or he never could have rebelled. God did not make him rebel, but the opportunity was there. Do you understand? Because God's all about free moral agents. He's not going to make you or anybody else do anything. Secondly, there are two categories of demons. Number one, the fallen and number two, the fallen and bound. Two different kinds of demons in the earth today. All of them began as angels. There's not some pre-Adamite race that some preacher dreamed up. God did not leave demons here to torment Adam and Eve. Are you listening? All right. So there are fallen and free. We call these free spirits, wicked spirits. They're in the world today. They're commonly referred to as demons. Secondly, there are angels of light. Now, these are not the positive. These are the negative. These are demon spirits, but they're called angels of light. I can tell you about a young girl whose home I went into. I said, "Where is your 5-year-old daughter?" And she said, "Well, I left her at the pool." "Well, is there anybody with her?" "No, nobody with her." And when I dug deeper into the thing, a spirit had manifested itself to her and told her that she was going to throw herself down the steps, and before she did that, take her child to the pool and put him on the edge of the pool. This is an angel of light. Your Bible calls Satan an angel of light. 2 Corinthians 11:14. Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. Matthew 12:24. Satan is the leader of these fallen and free demonic spirits called wicked spirits, and some of them take on the form of angels of light. That's the reason 1 John 4:1 says, "Test the spirits and know whether they're of God or not." Do you know that millions of people are deceived by preachers who are possessed by angels of light? They have great revelation. They just astound people. Angels of light to lead you astray. Secondly, there are the fallen and imprisoned spirits. 2 Peter 2:4, God did not spare the angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell. Now, this is the word Tartarus. There are several words for hell. Tartarus is a compartment in the intermediate hell, which is in the center of the earth. This is not the final hell. Are you listening? This is not the final hell. This is not where they will end up. Now, the reason this particular group of demons is not free, but your Bible says they are held in chains of darkness in a compartment of hell called Tartarus, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. Let me give you another verse. Jude 6, angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, God has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day. Do you know why they ended up there? So all of them were in the rebellion that Satan led. They were cast into the earth. Some of them are still free. They are the spirits that I could read to you many, many different instances that are involved in our world today. Things like in Germany right now, one of the major things going on is that businesses have developed where zoo animals are kept for the express purpose of men and women having sexual relations with the animals and paying the proprietors to do so. Erotic zoos, they're called. Man was just arrested in Florida for having relations, I'll say it that way, with one of those miniature donkeys, and they caught him in the act. Be honest right now what you're tempted by demon power about. You may not even know it's demon power tempting you. God tempts no man with evil. But we are tempted when we're drawn away. It's a fishing term, to lure. When we're drawn away and enticed, that's a hunting term, and enticed to surround by our own lust, our own desire. Don't think about it sexually in that connotation. By our own desire. Anything that I can't stop thinking of is an idol. Anything that I give all my heart is an idol. You with me? Temptation, when habitually kept at a distance, ceases to exist. If you have a problem with alcohol and you're getting on a commercial airplane, tell the stewardess, don't bring that by me. Well, I don't want to offend her. Better to offend her than for you to end up an alcoholic. If you have a problem with gossip, stay out of situations that gender it. I don't know how I got on this. Temptation, when habitually kept at a distance, ceases to exist. Resist the devil means flee, to run away. One Bible translation translates it this way: as running away with inspired fear and threatened danger. That'll kill you. You know why you run away when you hear and you're walking through a Texas field? Inspired fear and threatened danger. When you begin to treat your temptation with inspired fear and threatened danger, that thing will kill you. That thing will destroy your life. That thing will wreck your home. That thing will leave you shipwrecked. Cast that thought down. Shout, come out. Go. I resist you right now in word and deed. That means get up from the table and walk away. I was with Brother Copeland. We were sitting at a table with a bunch of preachers. And all of a sudden, they started talking about other preachers. And Brother Copeland just reached over and took me by the hand, took his napkin and his plate and said, grab yours, and moved us to another table. Now, these were nationally known preachers. He said, no, me and Brother Rod, we don't give ourselves to that. Hallelujah, praise God. Amen. Get up and walk away. I said, get up and walk away. Resist that thing. Don't let it become an imagination. Oh, hallelujah. I might ought to just quit now. Our struggle is not with flesh, but in the spirit, where we are always victorious. Your spirit shall sustain all your infirmity. Give it a chance. I feel like you're tired now. Yeah. When we encounter manifestations of demon power, we are to cast them out. Mark 16:17, these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. Some of you need to go home and take a bunch of those CDs, DVDs, and throw them out. Some of you need to turn your cable off. Too much of a temptation to you. By the way, what are your kids that are home, teenagers that are home right now watching? What are they filling your home with? And those spirits all in your house. Let me give you another quote I've lived by. To permit is to participate. You get pleasure out of watching somebody else do it. It won't belong to you're doing it. Dirty housewives. Amen. Don't shout me down now just because I'm preaching. You gentlemen spend a night in some hotel somewhere and watch some deplorable girl that's been sexually trafficked and made to make a movie, and you sit there in a room and watch it, and then come home, that spirit's on you, and try to make your wife do things that your Bible plainly teaches are an abomination. Uh-oh, now we've messed up. Somebody said, well, now, Brother Ron, the marriage bed is sanctified. It doesn't sanctify debauchery. Debauchery is still debauchery. Shall I get more specific? Just read your Bible. Certain things are made for certain things. You don't eat with your nose, and you don't talk with your ear. What you don't understand is you're allowing spirits of darkness to invade your life. Get it out! Clean it up! Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And it doesn't matter if you're having connections with your husband, or with your spouse, with your wife. Doesn't matter. Your body is still the temple of the Holy Ghost. He doesn't go to the next room like your children. Don't grieve him. Wow. I don't think you're going to invite me back. I think they've already turned off the screen in Elkhart and gone home. Hallelujah. Well, we might as well be real. Run, flee, as if inspired with danger. Get away. Put away all filthiness, and evil speaking, and clamor. Let not such things even be mentioned among you. Much less giggled at on your TV set every night. What are we talking about now? We're talking about give no place. Give no position of opportunity. Let me give you another translation of space limited by occupancy. Glory to God. When I was a little boy, Mother Parsley and my precious father would take us. We had a 64 Buick Skylark. That'd be 1964. How many of you were not alive in 1964? Well, you're here now. Hallelujah. Shout, I'm alive now. Well, a 1964 Buick Skylark. No air conditioner. It had 460 air conditioning. Four windows down and hit 60 miles an hour. Amen. We didn't stop at McDonald's either there. We had a green Coleman cooler in the trunk. You have the same thing, Joni? Yeah. Amen. Stop alongside the road, take out some trail bologna. Dad take out his pocket knife. I hate to think about what else he'd been cutting with that, but my mouth would go to watering. Get you a big sweet onion, tomato, some bread, or stick to the roof of your mouth when you bit into it. Doesn't that sound good? Good cold Pepsi Cola on ice in the bottle. Whoever came up with cans had an uninspired thought. You get that glass bottle and drink about that much out of it and take you a bag of Lance peanuts, salty, pour them down in that. I'll have an apple pie. And we'd go. I remember my dad coming in over on Marilla Road. No, it wasn't Marilla Road. No, it wasn't Marilla Road. It was in the White House, one before that. Anyway, over off Frank Road. I remember him coming in and saying, "Who's going to Florida today? Florida, that must be the other side of the world. We're going to the Free Will Baptist Convention." Put the Coleman cooler in there and big long trail bologna loaf. Off we went. And my dad, Mother Parsley, she'd start hollering, "It's going to get dark soon. We've been in this car for 12 hours. Well, we're just going to go a little further." And we weren't looking for the Hilton nor the Hyatt. And the motels had those signs, vacancy. We never did see one. My dad drives along, it was no vacancy everywhere. Had to keep driving to the next town. And then everybody closed up at dark, and gasoline stations closed down, and you got no gas. By this time, it's not pleasant in the 64 Buick Skylark. It's not pleasant now. And babies, sometimes, if we're really going to live like we ought to live, we got to put up a no vacancy sign. No, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. My body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. I have no room in my mind for anything other than what God's word says about me. Now I'm going to tell you what demons are. You want me to? It's 8:30, right on the nose. I said, I'm going to tell you what demons are now that I've told you how to get rid of them. If you will, the Arndt translation of the Bible says the devil will seek safety in flight. He'll flee. He'll seek safety in flight. I just believe tonight that on your way home, devils are going to seek safety in flight. That when you walk over the threshold of your house, you're going to take authority over every spirit but the Holy Spirit. You go into a hotel room and you open that door before you step across that threshold. Father, in the name of Jesus, a servant of God is about to step in this room. I thank you that every spirit other than the Holy Spirit that has been manifested in this room has to go now by the power of God. You walk into a hospital on visitation. Before you walk through there on the way from the parking lot, thank you, Lord. My body resists every sickness, every disease. There's nothing in here going to get on me, but some of what's in me is going to get on this. I bind every spirit. I bind every... Glory. Lytle and Scott say the devil will run off as quickly as possible. Put him to going. The expositor's Greek New Testament says he will be vanquished and run from your presence disgraced. There are differences between physical and emotional sickness and demonic activity. Just because somebody's sick doesn't mean a demon is involved. However, one could be. Shout till it almost physically hurts. Shout victory. Shout dominion. Shout authority. Shout glory. Glory! Glory! Shout because you can. Shout because you want to. Shout because there's nothing the devil can do about it. Because you can. Clap because you want to. Clap. Show your authority. Skin on skin. Let every devil know they have no authority in your life. Clap it out. Clap it out. Clap it out. Yeah. Seated. Blessed be the name of God forever. I said, blessed be the name of God forever. My pastor, my mentor, was recognized as one of the foremost authorities on demon power. Now, this is not for the spiritually weak of heart and mind. We are engaged in warfare. Look at your neighbor and say, this right up in here. Say it the way I say, this right up in here is not a recreation room. This is a battlefield. Now shout because you were built for the battle. You were created for the conflict. Luke 9:1 shouts it. Behold, I feel it in here now. Behold, 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 I give you power. Wonder-working power, sin-eradicating power, devil-destroying power, death to life again, power, tumor-driving out, power, confusion-rectifying, power, sleep disorder healing, power, heart malfunction, power. Behold! Oh, I feel like saying behold. Somebody's going to get an infusion. Somebody's about to realize you are on an irreversible collision course. There ain't nothing you can do about it now. You're committed. You come far. You have advanced too far into enemy-held territory to not have to fight. You ought to just get a... You ought to just get happy because you got the devil on the run. You wouldn't have to fight if you weren't where you are. You wouldn't have to fight if God didn't think you could win. God already placed his bet on Calvary and doubled it when he raised him from the dead and said, the same spirit that raised up Christ from the dead now dwells in you. The only reason to have a body is just to express the life that's in it. So go ahead and let her go. Lay a couple of things out. You be seated. You might just as well get happy because you come way too far to turn back now. You have already gained hell's attention. They have you in their sight. Just smile at them real big. God, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Satan hath desired to have you. Now there was a reason that he didn't pick out John the Apostle or Matthew or Mark or Luke. He specifically, with great specificity, zeroed in on Simon Peter. And he said, Simon, yeah, you better wake up, Simon. Satan, not a demon. I'll talk, Satan has desired to have you. There's a prophecy for you. Actual translation is Satan has requisition because he can't do anything without permission. What, did you think I was going to come in here tonight and brag on the devil? He's defeated. Can't have my mind, can't have my body, can't have my family, can't have my future, can't have my money, can't have my church. Somebody needs to go ahead and shout. He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet.
He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet.
Yes, he is.
You might just well know it. You may see it. You might just well know it. It's over for you. You turn around and show fear now. You are way too deep in the enemy held territory. Don't let him see you sweat. Don't let him see you fear. Don't let him see you in trepidation. Don't let him hear you do anything but glorify God. who gives you the victory. I have no thought of defeat. I have no thought of demise. I have no thought of falling. No. I'm saying a whole lot more than you're getting. You, Shaddai, have come too far into enemy-held territory. You flinch now. You've had it. I'm preaching to somebody. You could have shown him fear. You were over at the frozen chosen. You just assigned a couple of little failures to torment you a little bit. But look at you now. Born again. Blood washed. You looking like your daddy. Talking like your elder brother. Moving like the Holy Ghost. You've come too far now. There is no retreat for you now. Dude, I'm telling you, I'm under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost right now. Don't let him see you flinch. And if you feel like flinching, grab four people around you and say, just stand around me and shout. You flinch now and it'll open the door to some disease. You flinch now and he'll get a headway into your children. Don't you flinch now. Are you kidding me? You're a part of a church? Harvest Preparatory School. Went to a track meet last week. And the bus driver just sat on the bus. A track meet. And the bus driver just sitting on the bus. Waiting on the children, you know. Waiting on the athletes. Somebody came knocking on the bus door. May I help you? Yeah. Did you go to that church? Yeah. Well, I need to get saved. He knelt down on the bus, gave his life to Jesus, and got up speaking in other tongues. You come too far. You with a crazy bunch now. You've been identified. You've been marked out. Mess around with this now. You can't play at it now. You can't ease up now. And why would you want to? Every time you shout, they scream. Every time you rejoice, they retreat. Every time you glorify, they get bludgeoned. Hey! Behold, I give you power over all devils and to cure diseases. Go ahead and ask three people, you got anything you need cured of? Because you're on the right pew. Now just pray for everybody on your pew right now to be healed. Just release that anointing right there in Elkhart, Indiana. Release it. Release it right here. Be healed. Rebuke that torment. Rebuke that sad spirit. Rebuke that downcast attitude. Now just glorify God that he's just touched 1,000 people. I give you power over all devils and to cure diseases. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power. That young man right back there with the white shirt and the glasses, climb over every pew and come to me right now. Everybody else get to glorifying God. Oh, it's you. All I saw was a white shirt. But I saw, as it were, as Moses was parting the Red Sea and the waters were rolling back, so is the door that I placed before you, says the Lord. And there will come an anointing from generations past.